Good morning. A very, very feeble good morning. Shall we try that again? Good morning.
Good morning.
Excellent. Very nice to see you too. It's really good to be with you as we gather for worship today here at St. James. If you're new, it's really great to have you with us. Make sure you say hello to people before you go. Do stop afterwards for coffee. If you'd like someone to pray with you, do stop afterwards over here. And there'll be people there. We'll be happy to do that. If you're normally here, it's lovely to see you too. Welcome, welcome all. So really, really great to gather here this morning. Mandy's going to be preaching to us later. But for the moment, why don't we begin with prayer. Prayer preparation should be up on the screen. Let's pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. We start by magnifying that holy name of God. Music group will be leading.
And what better place to start than with the resurrection? Christ is risen. That is why we have hope. So we sing, "See What a Morning." response is our praise to God, our praise to Jesus for what he has done for us. And so we're continuing. Praise is rising, eyes are turning to God.
Before a God who gives us gifts of salvation, of life, of all that we need to sustain us and keep us. And week by week, we remind ourselves that the things we give back to God are simply our return of his good gifts to us. So we join together in our offertory prayer. Yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. Amen. Do take a seat. The next small gift to be received are the notices, which I'm sure you've been looking forward to. You'll find them on the yellow sheet. You may have been emailed them. Do have a careful look at them. If you are getting them live, as it were, this week, then there's a mission link in with them. So news about our mission partners. You can see a picture of Judy and Bishop Given on the front cover, doing something important, looking, exchanging papers of one sort or another, but all sorts of good stuff there to remind us of those we pray for and support in various places around the world. Worth saying thank you to those who are helping to make this service happen. I know there's been a little bit of confusion about that this week, so I think I'm right in saying Shandon and Ravensworth are the key players as things have ended up. But thank you to all who are helping to make things run smoothly and well this morning. In terms of the notices, I think the main thing to say is just stuff is starting again. We've got Children's Church this morning, but all sorts of other groups and activities are getting back underway. Do have a look on the notice sheet itself for more information about that. Judy is going to come and say something about various bits of training which are available. Over to you.
Thank you. I'm enjoying just sitting, being part of the congregation, but you know, I do like to be at the front for one tiny bit. I just really want to encourage people to think about the course Caring Concerns that we're doing. It is, we all want to be better at walking beside people and caring for them, praying for them, listening to them. And this course is taking part. It's a deanery-wide course, so all the churches in Tunbridge Wells have been invited to it. We're doing it in St. Mark's Church, and it's five Tuesday evenings. It will be brilliant if quite a few people, a couple of people have already signed up for here, but quite a few people from here sign up as we begin to think about how we're going to become a more caring and pastoral church in the next year. So please do take, I think you were emailed the form, but if you need one, there's one at the back. Do take one and fill it in and come to the course. It should be really good. Even though I say so myself, I'm doing some of it, and Claire Allwood, who is the vicar of St. Mark's, is doing it as well with me. So do please sign up, whatever age, whatever sort of people you care for. Some people think, oh, it's only for people who are look after older people. Actually, all of us need care and support at different stages. So anyone who is interested in doing that and learning to do that a bit better, please do sign up. Great.
Thank you, Judy. Well, in just a moment, time for our young people to go out. Shall we pray for them before they do? You call us all to be part of your church here at St. James. We pray now for our young people as they head out to their groups. We pray that you will go with them, that they'll meet with you and they'll receive the blessing of your word and your spirit in all they do. In Jesus' name, amen. Wonderful. So, young people, up and out to mainly to the hall, I think. We'll be continuing with our time of confession as we bring before God those things where we have gone astray, headed off on the wrong path. We're looking at Psalm 49 this morning, and a few words from Psalm 49 as we begin. For all can see that wise men die, the foolish and the senseless alike perish, and leave their wealth to others. But man, despite his riches, does not endure. He is like the beasts that perish. This is the fate of those who trust in themselves. But God will redeem my life from the grave. He will surely take me to himself. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commands and to live in love and peace with all. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us, forgive us all that is past and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We respond to that by standing to say the words of the glory together. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High. Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in the glory of God the Father. Amen. As we stand, let us pray. Almighty God, who called your church to bear witness that you were in Christ reconciling the world to yourself, help us to proclaim the good news of your love, that all who hear it may be drawn to you through him who was lifted up on the cross and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. To take a seat, we come now to our two readings from the scriptures. I think Roger is on first and then Hella is on straight after. So Hella, you might want to come forward as well, perhaps. And he will be speaking to us.
Our first reading is Psalm 49, which you can find on page 571 of the Pew Bibles. Psalm 49. Hear this, all you peoples. Listen, all who live in the world, both low and high. rich and poor alike. My mouth will speak words of wisdom. The utterance from my heart will give understanding. I will turn my ear to a proverb. With the harp I will expound my riddle. Why should I fear when the evil days come, when wicked deceivers surround me? Those who trust in their wealth and boast of their great riches. No man can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for him. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough that he should live on forever and not see decay. For all can see that wise men die. The foolish and the senseless alike will perish and leave their wealth to others. Their tombs will remain their houses forever, their dwellings for endless generations, though they had named lands after them. But man, despite his riches, does not endure. He is like the beasts that perish. This is the fate of those who trust in themselves and of their followers who approve their sayings. Like sheep, they are destined for the grave, and death will feed in them. The upright will rule over them in the morning. Their forms will decay in the grave, far from their princely mansions. But God will redeem my life from the grave. He will surely take me to himself. Do not be overawed when a man grows rich, when the splendor of his house increases, for he will take nothing with him when he dies. His splendor will not descend with him. Though while he lived, he counted himself blessed, and men praise you when you prosper, he will join the generations of his fathers, who will never see the light of life. A man who has riches without understanding is like the beasts that perish. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel reading is taken from Matthew 16, 21 to 28. From that time on, Jesus began to explain to his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things at the hands of the elders, the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and that he must be killed and the third day be raised to life. Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. "Never, Lord," he said. "This shall never happen to you." Jesus turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You're a stumbling block to me. You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." Then Jesus said to his disciples, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up the cross and follow me. Whoever wants to save their life will lose it. Whoever loses their life me will find it. What good would it be for someone to gain the whole world yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for that soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in his Father's glory with his angels, and then he will reward each person according to what they have done. Truly, I tell you, some of you are standing here will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming to this kingdom." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Please do sit down. And good morning. Last time I was in church, Roger was speaking, and he said that someone's sermon had been left there, and it's mine. Okay. If any of you did see me furiously scribbling, I wasn't finishing my sermon. I was trying to copy a prayer from my phone, which I didn't manage to do, so I will read it from my phone a little later on. But let's just pray before we start. Father God, thank you for bringing us here this morning, and please use my words to teach us something about your amazing glory. Amen. Amen. Right. Today we are continuing our series on the Psalms. Today we're looking at Psalm 49. As you've probably gathered, it's not a jumping around with joy psalm, but let's have a look at it. It's another psalm written by the sons of Korah, musicians from the tribe of Levites. The Levites were in charge, were appointed to look after the tabernacle and the temple. You may find it helpful to have your Bible or your phone handy. I will be jumping about a bit, not literally, obviously, because I'd probably fall out of the pulpit. Psalm 49 is not a psalm which on first reading, or several readings, strikes you as being particularly joyous. There is no shouting for joy in this psalm. This is known as a wisdom psalm, written for the purpose of teaching and instruction. The opening four verses of this psalm are very similar in wording to the book of Proverbs. The book of Proverbs, you know, is a book of short sayings and some poetry, written mainly by King Solomon. And its purpose is to teach wisdom to God's people. The opening verse of Proverbs says, the Proverbs of Solomon, Solomon, son of David, king of Israel. And the first verse, or the second verse, is for gaining wisdom and instruction, for understanding words of insight. So it was for teaching. And the Psalms, of course, were written hundreds of years before the birth of Jesus. They were not written for us, but for ancient peoples who lived really different lives from ours. But there are similarities and comparisons relevant to us today as they were then. I also love the fact that the Psalms would have been the hymn book of Jesus himself. He would have used them in worship, sung them, and prayed them. Right towards the end of Matthew's Gospel, 26:30, just says this: when they had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Possibly that was probably a psalm, maybe the last that Jesus said before his crucifixion, though he did say a word from the psalm as he was on the cross. The first four verses of Psalm 49 are directed to all people to listen, no matter what their status in life. I've used the contemporary English version just because I think it's a little bit easier. It says, "Everyone on this earth, now listen to what I say. Listen, no matter who you are, rich or poor. I speak words of wisdom, and my thoughts make sense. I have a mind in mystery that I will explain while playing my harp." I mean, that the language is not the same, is it? It's, when you go to verses 5 to 10, the writer then says, why should I fear bad things? Bad things happen to everyone, no matter who we are, rich and poor. And he goes on to say, being wealthy cannot stop the aging process. Death is inevitable in the end. It doesn't matter who you are. That's really cheerful, isn't it? But it's true. We can't stop the aging process, no matter how much some of us might try to spend a lot on face cream. Why should I be afraid? Again, it's the CEV version. In times of trouble, when I am surrounded by vicious enemies, they trust in their riches and brag about their wealth. You cannot buy back your life or pay off God. It costs too much. Redeeming is how the NIV puts it. I just think it's helpful sometimes to read it in a different translation. The psalm carries on in this rather bleak way. It does not matter how powerful you are in life, how clever, how praised. Your final home is the grave. The Hebrew view of death at the time the Psalms were written was rather a grim and bleak one. They believed that everyone descended to Sheol when they died. Sheol was the place where you went when you died. No exceptions. God did not go down to Sheol. You could not praise God or have any of the power or qualities that made up a real life, so you wouldn't have been anything of what you were when you were alive. An existence after death was all it was. And this view carried on for sort of hundreds of years. Indeed, the Pharisees or Sadducees didn't believe in in resurrection. There is a strange story in in 1 Samuel 28, 7 to 20, if you want to read it sometime. King Saul, terrified of defeat in battle, God has already left him at this point, has turned from God. He's so terrified, he visits a medium who summons up the prophet Samuel, who she describes as rising up through the ground. So if this story is true, then indeed they would have gone down when they died. The rest of this psalm continues in this way. Putting your trust in wealth or worldly things is pointless, meaningless. And this psalm, I think, in some ways echoes the book of Ecclesiastes, the book of the Bible written by the fabulously wise and wealthy King Solomon, who was in later life searching for meaning. And he wrote Ecclesiastes, and it begins, "Meaningless, meaningless, says the teacher, utterly meaningless, everything is meaningless." This is a man, a king, who had absolutely everything, and he is still not knowing what the meaning of his life is, and this was much later on in his reign. Psalm continues, "Do not be overawed by wealth. No matter how successful you are, it is transient, left behind." The psalm finishes with a final flourish in 19 and 20, if you weren't depressed enough. "But we each will go down to our ancestors, never again to see the light of day. Our human glory disappears, and like animals, we die." It's not really a singing and dancing one, is it? However, before you're thoroughly depressed, there is a flicker of hope. We heard it this morning. A flash forward to redemption. Verse 15, the psalmist says, "But God will redeem me from the realm of the dead. He will surely take me to himself." God did not want his people to die. He will reach down into the depths to redeem them. And the psalmist gives that hope. Do not rely on money. Do not rely on worldly things. Rely on God. In our gospel reading this morning, Jesus is telling the disciples of his forthcoming death. He rebukes Peter because Peter says, "No way, you're not going to die, Lord." Jesus knows he has to die because that's the only way that he can redeem us. Mark 10:45, "For even the Son of Man did not come to be served but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many." This is the ransom that he's given for us. So how do we interpret this psalm for today? We know Jesus gave his life so that we can be with him. That starts in this life, here and now, when we turn from our old lives to a new life in Jesus. Life in God's kingdom actually started on earth when Jesus died and rose again. We know that he went back to heaven, ascended in his glorious, risen, earthly body. We know that he sent his Spirit onto the disciples on the first Pentecost. And we know that the Spirit of Jesus is available to all of us believers here today. We only have to ask. How do we live in that light, though? Psalm 49 talks a lot about wealth. It runs through the psalm. It is okay to be wealthy. A lot of great and good generosity comes from those who have much. Jesus did speak a lot during his ministry about wealth. He says in Matthew 19:24 that it's easier for a camel to pass through the eye of a needle than for a rich man get into the kingdom of heaven. Nothing wrong with being rich, but Jesus knew that the young man in Matthew 19, who we often refer to as the rich young ruler, was very devout, but he was also very rich. And when Jesus asked him to sell everything and follow him, he struggled because he knew all his stuff, all his possessions, and he couldn't give them all up. And that was holding him back from committing everything to God. Jesus knew when observing a widow putting a tiny coin in the temple offering that she had given everything she had. We all have stuff. There's nothing wrong with stuff. I do have too much stuff. I do have rather a lot of China cat ornaments. Tasteful, not horrible. Jesus was a radical fighter for truth and justice, championing the marginalised and the oppressed. And we are called to do this today. Poverty and injustice rage on just as they did 2,000 plus years ago. We are called to live generously, to share our stuff, to give generously of what we have. And it's often, isn't it, that people that have less often can sometimes be much more joyful. I think the heart of Psalm 49 is this. God does not care about whether we are rich or poor, have much or little. He does not care about how powerful we are, because we are all equal in the eyes of God. We will one day leave our earthly possessions behind us. The only thing that matters is our belief, our trust in God, in the saving power of Jesus. But how do we live in that light? There is so much advertising everywhere on TV, on our screens, phones, beautiful shop displays, making us think that we need more stuff. Sometimes we do. But sometimes it can make us dissatisfied with our lives as they are. There is a Julia Donaldson book. I have read it many times to various small people over my years in preschool. It's called A Squash and a Squeeze. You probably know it. And every time I read the story, I am reminded of all I have to be thankful for. The story begins with an old woman complaining that her house is much too small. I'm not looking at Noel here because I complain that my house is much too small. She enlists the help of a wise old man who tells her first to take the hen in, then to take the pig in, and on until our home is full of animals with barely any room to move. She finally returns to the wise old man and he tells her to let all of the animals out again. She does and is surprised at how spacious her house now feels. It is no longer too small. Do we need to be more satisfied with what we have, to rely more on God and less on ourselves, to see God in our everyday lives and things around us? Now, I left it there. I was unsure how to finish this sermon, and Noel was prayer pastoring last night. And Doreen, the prayer coordinator, was reading a book by a chap called Brian Gaunt, who was born with no arms. He was 1961, so he was a thalidomide baby. So many of us that age could have been affected by this. I mean, my mother was offered this anti-sickness drug and said no. Anyway, he went to Bible college. He's written a book called No Hands. He was sent on secondment to a church in Tunbridge Wells. Can you guess the name of the church? It was St. James. And he ran an after-school club here in 1989, and well over 90 children attended that week. In his book, he uses this prayer. Now, I'm going to finish with this. Hopefully, here it is. I'm going to read it from my phone. He used this prayer in his book. I asked God for strength that I might achieve. I was made weak that I might learn humbly to obey. I asked for health that I might do greater things. I was given infirmity that I might do better things. I asked for riches that I might be happy. I was given poverty that I might be wise. I asked for power that I might have the praise of men. I was given weakness that I might feel the need of God. I asked for all things that I might enjoy life. I was given life that I might enjoy all things. I got nothing that I asked for, but everything I had hoped for. Almost despite myself, my unspoken prayers were answered. I am among all men most richly blessed. Amen.
Thank you, Mandy. We respond in song as we look at the glory of things God has done for us. focus our lives on those things that lead to the grave. May we focus our life on that one, that person, himself risen from the dead, with whom we too can rise and live. And we can affirm that faith now in the words of the Nicene Creed. I think we'll say these all together today. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. He was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Do sit or kneel as we come to our prayers of intercession. These are Kay's prayers that she wrote, but we pray them all together. So let us pray. Praise you, Father, for you have put wisdom in our mouths and understanding in our hearts. We will meditate on your ways. We thank you for your words in Scripture that encourage, correct, and teach us. Even your disciples did not get it right all the time. Thank you for sermons, for house group sessions, for podcasts and Bible studies that help us to think about your word. We pray for all the groups starting again after the summer break, for leaders and teachers as they prepare sessions. We pray for Judy, our vicar, for Anna, our youth worker, and for all those who lead and teach at St. James. Give them opportunities to be led by you, so they in turn can feed others. We will not fear in times of trouble. While others put their trust in wealth, we will trust in your provision for us. Thank you for all you have given us as a church, and for the chance to support others. We pray for ABC and Who Let the Dads Out, which meet again this week. We pray for the volunteers that they would be able to share love and practical support with those who come. We pray for our mission partners, and particularly for SAT7. Iranian Christians are suffering for their faith, and we pray for Farshid Farthi, an Iranian Christian who went to prison for his faith. He recently laid out his view of suffering and persecution, forged through experience, on SAT7's programme New Identity. We pray that this programme would greatly encourage those who watch it. Our life is not our own. The blood of Jesus has ransomed it. Help us to live as children of God. We pray for St James's School as the children return on Tuesday. Last term was very difficult as some classrooms were unusable, and now all around the country schools are faced with the same problem. We pray for all governors, head teachers, staff and children. Thank you for the provision of the youth centre run by Tunbridge Wells Youth for Christ. They're open tomorrow after school, particularly for new Year 7 students. We pray for all the new students as they make this transition to secondary school. May they make good friends and find supportive teachers. Praise you, Lord Jesus Christ, for you have saved us from destruction. You have set our feet on solid ground. You are Lord forever. We pray for those who are struggling at the moment, for those who face uncertainty, illness, operations, or tests. In the silence, we lift up to you those we know who need your healing and your compassion. Our life is in you, Lord. Our hope is in you, and our destiny is intertwined with your goodness and your mercy. We will trust in you today. Amen. Will you please stand? Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let us share with one another a sign of that peace. Peace be with you, my dear. You there. Peace be with you. Peace be with you. As we prepare to share with one another around God's table in a few moments, we come now to sing again. We come as guests invited.
Jesus is the light of time. it.
The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to praise you, Father, Lord of all creation. In your love, you made us for yourself. When we turned away, you did not reject us, but came to meet us in your Son. You embraced us as your children and welcomed us to sit and eat with you. In Christ, you shared our life, that we might live in him and he in us. He opened his arms of love upon the cross and made for all the perfect sacrifice for sin. On the night he was betrayed, at supper with his friends, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His body is the bread of life. At the end of supper, taking the cup of wine, he gave you thanks and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me." Father, we do this in remembrance of him. His blood is shed for all. As we proclaim his death and celebrate his rising in glory, send your Holy Spirit that this bread and this wine may be to us the body and blood of your dear Son. As we eat and drink these holy gifts, make us one in Christ, our risen Lord. With your whole church throughout the world, we offer you this sacrifice of praise and lift our voice to join the eternal song of heaven. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Please sit or kneel as we continue in prayer. As our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ. Though we are many, we are one body, because we all share in one bread. Instructions about how communion will work today. For those who want to receive the common cup and the bread separately, there'll be a station at the front here, and there'll be a station at the front on that side. People in that aisle come forward there, people in the centre aisles come forward here. For those who'd like a wafer dipped into the wine, there'll be a single station at the back. When you're called out, if you want a dipped wafer, head in the back direction rather than the front direction. We'll see if this works more effectively than last time. The general invitation is to draw near with faith. Receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith. With thanksgiving. Pray together. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed by his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Body of Christ. Thank you. We pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen. We stand for our closing song, Amazing Grace. Would you stand?
Amen.
If you'd like to take part in that small foretaste of the resurrection life, which is tea and coffee, then do go through to the hall in just a moment. If you'd like someone to pray with you, over here in the prayer corner is the right place. If you'd like to know more about the Care and Concerns course, have a word with Judy or with me if that would be helpful. We hold a moment of quiet before we pray for God's blessing upon us all. Moment of quiet. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. In the name of Christ, amen.
You're going to the library today, love? Yeah. Thought you might be. She's got a big bag with us.
Yeah. Oh, I didn't know that. That's in the new building, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, it's not a new building, so.
Well, you know, yeah.
We've done a lot to it, though, haven't we? Yeah.
I mean, it's not where it... Or is it where it...